in person. I want to welcome all those that are watching online. I'll call the meeting to order and acknowledge that we're on Treaty 1 land and traditional homeland of the Métis. First, just begin by asking for adoption of the minutes of the previous meeting.
So moved, Mr. Chair.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thanks. Before we move to delegations, I just want to offer a huge congratulations to John Morris and Caitlin Laws, who hopefully everybody knows by now won a historic win at the Olympics. I know all Canadians and all Winnipeggers are thrilled with this morning's gold medal win. And so, as I mentioned on social media this morning, the Winnipeg sign is lit up in gold and red for the next 2 days to honor two incredible Canadians. And I know everyone at St. Vital this morning was quite happy. Turn it over to Councillor Mason.
It was a 4:40 a.m. wake-up call today to get to the club for 5. By the time I got there, it was almost full already. So including Jeff from CBC was there doing double duty, so thank you for coming out. And I see Chris Cothers, who wasn't there, but is a great St. Vital Curling Club parent, who I've seen there many times. So, yeah, it was a great day for the club. And We'll have to revise the. I already talked to Take Pride, who said they're in to, you know, add something to the mural that's on the side of the building. So we'll figure that out. And I was asked if I'd be naming a street, and I said, well, we got Jennifer Jones Park, and we've got Jill Officer Park, so maybe a park. But we'll talk to Ms. Laws upon her return and see what she'd like us to do. But I also want to thank the mayor, who was. They had a whole profile last night at Caitlin Laws, and there was the mayor at St. Vital Curling Club talking about the importance of curling in that club. So much appreciate the mayor came out to the launch. But I think I had some parenting duties this morning and couldn't make the 5 a.m. wake-up call. But, yeah, great day in St. Vital.
Yeah, it was amazing. Okay, let's get on with our work here. We have delegations.
First delegation, Gord Delbridge, president of QP Local 500, to be heard in support of the pilot project for multifamily solid waste collection services.
Welcome. Morning.
Good morning. Thanks for the opportunity to come and speak to you today in support of this issue. It's nice for a change to be able to stand in support of a recommendation that's being put forward.
Should you from now on?
I hope so. I just want to say that I really sincerely think this is a step in the right direction. This gives us an opportunity to really evaluate and compare this service coming in house. We've had very good discussions, I can tell you, with the Water and Waste Department, Moira Gear, the acting director, and her staff, along with my staff. I think they've been very productive, and we know now that the garbage collection contract, that the main contract that was awarded, it was often touted that part of the driving costs not to bring that work back in-house was labor costs, and from our research we found now that the contractor, the labor costs are actually significantly more or quite a bit more than what it would be for us to do that work in-house, even when you take into consideration the pensions and benefits. So we're quite confident that by working together that we can find ways to not only improve the quality of service of delivering the service, but be more cost effective as well. And I think this gives us a good opportunity. I think it's going to be important, though, that we do a very thorough analysis of comparing all aspects when we do our cost comparisons. But we got to look at it in many other aspects as well. When we're outsourcing this work and we're taking private contracts to contractors that are based outside of Winnipeg to multinational corporations that are taking a lot of money out of our economy, that has to be taken into consideration as well. I can tell you that by doing this work here in-house, your staff, our members, their paychecks are spent here in our community, which is better for our local economy. And I think that has to be taken into consideration as well. So if you've got any questions, I'd be willing to take any questions, but I'll keep it short, and I just want to say, you know, I think this is a really good opportunity, a good step in the right direction, and look forward to seeing how this all transpires.
Thank you. Have a great day.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming in.
Next delegation, Colin Neufeld and Alex Borsma from Legatum Developments, Inc., to be heard with respect to the request to amend servicing agreement condition for file DASZ 29 of 2016.
Can I present on the... Here we go.
Morning and welcome.
Good morning. Mayor Roman, councillors, thanks for this opportunity to present. I guess once again, we presented 2 weeks ago to Standing Policy Committee as well as Community Committee, I guess a number of weeks before that on this topic. I'm the architect with 546-8796 Architecture. We've been working with Alex Borsma and his partner Ryan for a little over 2 years on this property and trying to get it off the ground and moving. I'll try to go quickly, but to give everybody some context, this is the property in question here is on the corner of Ducharme and Pembina Highway. It sort of is one of the last pieces on Ducharme as a sort of a small infill lot. It's made up of two single-family house lots right now that are being amalgamated into a single lot and rezoned from an RR5 designation to a multifamily designation to allow for basically the completion of this portion of Pembina Highway and the development of apartments and condominiums along it. It has proven to be a rather tricky property to develop, to put it mildly. I'm going to walk you through that as quickly as I can. I could also hand out these at the idea that you may not now watch my presentation. I'll give it to you. This is the same thing that's going to be on the screen, but maybe help for questions after. This property, as it's being redeveloped, as I said already, I guess is an infill lot on this corner that has the support of the neighborhood committee. There's a design committee that reviews all the designs. We've gone through a number of iterations of what it might look like. This is what it is right now, which we think is a rather sort of exciting project that sort of takes and modernizes some of the French sort of vernacular architecture and really makes it into something that we can all be proud of. This is a view sort of from Pembina Highway looking between or along the drainage coulee or the little creek that runs through the property. As when Alex and Ryan first came to us, this is what they came to us with. They had bought these two houses and had looked at redeveloping it. The city had sort of said, yeah, we would support rezoning it and making it into multifamily. This represents sort of using the whole lot, building about 20 apartment-style suites along with surface parking, which would be in keeping with what the rest of the development along Pembina there is. So that's where we started designing. This is the lot that they purchased. There was a City of Winnipeg easement for the coulee on it, and we started sort of looking at it. We talked to Elise Finnegan in the planning office, and one of the first things that came about rather quickly was the proximity to the rail line. And if there's been a requirement or a recommendation from CN for a number of years now to in terms of how to develop next to rail lines. This is, in quick terms, this is what it would mean. If you want to develop up to the green line, then you would have to build a berm, a 15-meter berm or a 50-foot berm on your property to protect from derailment. And if you wanted to do nothing on your property and just have space sort of be that safety, then you would only be able to build up to the red line, which essentially cuts the developable area of this lot in half. This is an important piece because it's a piece that's been in place for quite a while, but is only recently being enacted or enforced, not enacted, I guess, enforced by the City of Winnipeg. And it really, when you'll see at the end, or if you flip to the last page and what we handed out, you'll see how the rest of the properties along to the north of us have all developed within that line with no berm or crash walls or any mitigating pieces. So it's an important piece, but it wasn't the only piece that happened to this lot. The next one was the City of Winnipeg easement represents an easement specifically for that drainage coulee, but it also has undergone, it's being used a lot more. To put it bluntly, in the last 10 years with the redevelopment of properties to the west of us, the drainage, there's a lot more volume of drainage going through here. Its bank is required to be looked at as a riverbank as a result, and this became the developable portion that was left on the property, was just this front corner. And we still haven't taken off the front yard or side yard setbacks. So it is sort of become a piece that is not developable, or it's far from where it was at the beginning in terms of surface parking, some modest sort of single or townhouse style development. So something that can be done within the recommendations of the CN document is you can build a berm, or you can even build a crash wall to mitigate the danger of a derailment. If you do that, you can develop quite a ways back towards the rail line, which started to make this a piece that could be developed. This comes with a price tag. The price tag is listed there of $100,000. That is basically just the cost for the concrete and rebar. When you start to add up all the other costs, it made this into a structured parking development, which meant that to offset the cost of the structured parking, you had to build more units. The next slide shows that by building this and moving towards the rail line to get a decent piece of land that you could actually develop, the hydro line now has to be buried due to the proximity to it, the overhead, which everybody else along this strip is overhead. Now it has to be buried. That came at a cost of plus or minus $53,000. And I guess that brings us to what we're asking today is a cumulative effect has landed on this servicing agreement. And so there's an appetite and a spirit and a desire to redevelop this land and build something that sort of is in keeping with the rest of the city and what's been developed along Pembina Highway. And so we want to do that. These costs have sort of been cumulative, and the last one that is, I guess, negotiable or can be waived is the servicing agreement. It isn't that we are requesting that the servicing agreement is somehow injurious or was unknown or anything like that, but that that it is the one that doesn't impact the life safety of the of occupants on the land, and it doesn't impact the quality, such as pushing the hydro line underneath, or the long-term quality of rivers and streams and this riverbank. So those things to us seem like they became non-negotiable almost as we went along. I know at SPC we heard that there's a danger of setting a precedent of waiving a servicing agreement, and we recognize that. I guess we would leave you with a couple of comments that there's a precedent already being set on this property, and that is this is the first development that we know of along Pembina Highway that is actually meeting the guidelines of the CN recommendations. And so by building this crash wall and making a safer environment for this development, we didn't ask for that to be waived. I know we have in the past with other developments, and all of the others have been granted that along the way. We feel that it actually should be enforced, and we're setting that precedent by doing that. That, as I already presented, triggered the pushing of the hydro underneath. The other thing that in setting this precedent of waiving the servicing agreement, none of these other properties along Pembina Highway, they were all developed under a previous administration and under a previous time, but under the same guidelines, and their fees were not enforced either. So there is a precedent to alleviate those fees. Given the precedent, the number of precedents that are being set on this property, we sort of would like to ask you to consider waiving this one as not having the sort of life safety effect that the others do. We've only got sort of 20 seconds left, so I think I'll leave it there, but that would be, I would open it to questions. And
not hearing any.
I just might have one quick one.
That's right.
Quick scan of the report. You say the other properties did not have to pay the servicing agreement. I don't see that in the report. Where does that information come from?
It comes from research with both Greg Jasper, like Public Works, I don't know, and our own research through meeting minutes, etc. So that's been confirmed. Not every one of them would have been subject to it. When you rezone from RR5 to, it's specific to rezoning from RR5 to a multifamily. And so I think it's two out of the number here were rezoned from that designation to the multifamily, and they weren't charged. I could provide that in writing, but that has been confirmed.
Okay. Great, thank you. Yeah.
As a member of Real Community Committee, I feel like I've seen this movie a number of times, but can you just summarize so people here are clear? The core issue here is both the drain, I guess, two issues, the costs related to the drainage, as well as, and perhaps more so, the crash wall. So can you just speak? I know we've discussed crash wall at some enormous length at the Community Committee, but if you can just sort of highlight your best case as to why this fee should be waived in light of some of the other expenses that you've incurred.
So the crash wall was something that was brought up early on, and we started looking at the cost implications of it and trying to stay away from doing it. I think in the end it became the only reasonable way to ensure life safety if we were to enact the guidelines of or the recommendations of CN. And so it became a cost borne by the project that had to be absorbed, but I think I'm not sure if I'm following your question, Brian, exactly. But when we're looking at all of the costs that are sort of periphery to the development of this and the sort of bricks and mortar costs of doing this development, the servicing agreement is one that there is a precedent of waiving, and there is and doesn't add value to the property. And I think all of the others add value to the property and are something that the client, even though they didn't want to do them at the beginning, sees the value that's being added and is willing to do them. But this, the cumulative effect has really rendered this project on the sort of knife edge of being viable. And at this point, if it doesn't become viable, they've invested literally hundreds of thousands of dollars in consultant fees, et cetera, and it's a rather risky proposition at the moment to not be viable. And so that's, and this is the last fee that sort of is there that can help alleviate some of those cumulative effects.
Okay. Very good. Thank
those
you.
Those aren't just your fees, right?
No, not just, but we have significant
yeah.
fees.
Yeah. You know, I do appreciate the diligence in your presentation. I'll be asking the public service just when we consider the report just to speak as to why their recommendation isn't to support the requested amendments. But I do appreciate your presentation today, Councillor Orlico.
Probably wordsmithing here a bit. You said there's precedent from other groups being waived. I don't recall. Are you saying council waived the fees for other properties, or they were never charged?
I could be. I don't know.
Sorry,
I don't know if it came to council or not. If it was waived at Public Works, or maybe I'm using the wrong term, but they weren't charged.
They weren't charged. That's
all I know.
That's what we know. Okay. Yeah, because waiving would be.
You're right. I don't know if there's a precedent from this committee waiving.
Well, and we'll get that information later on.
Okay. Cool. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks.
Good.
No further delegations, Your Worship.
Okay, so we'll move to reports. As the sharpens down there, so we'll move to EPC reports. First one is grant expenditures in election year. Councilor Mays.
I'll move that and speak to it very briefly. My thanks to Councilor Pratikan for supporting this. Perhaps he and I both felt a bit the sting of the editorial in the Free Press about 4 years ago that talked about this issue. So pleased to see we're able to come back and make some recommendations to try and level the playing field a bit in the coming city elections.
Councilor Dillingham?
Just a question. I'm just wondering if, through you, Mr. Chair, to Councilor Mays, it's specific to making funding announcements. Pertaining to expenditures, I'm wondering is it restricted? I trust it's restricted to that because if we've invested as councillors into something that maybe a project is complete, right? The funding has already been, you know, we announced the funding the year prior, but the project, whether it's a park or whatever it may be, is complete, you know, completed inside that 60-day time frame, and there's some sort of opening or something like that. That wouldn't count. This is just about announcing new funding, correct?
Yes, and in fact, I got trashed 4 years ago for supposedly announcing something in September, which we'd actually opened in July, but the CanStar paper wrote a very positive, generous article about it in September, though, and therefore always felt that I had somehow run afoul. I did make other tweets about other grants. So, yeah, the devil is in the detail of the word announcements, I suppose, but I mean the intent is, yes, you can vote for something at September Community Committee and approve it, but this is trying to limit announcements, and people have to define that, yes, but you can't be faulted if the media covers something 5 weeks after you've made the announcement. Nothing one can do about that, but yeah, it's the intent is you still have to do your job as a councillor. It's just in that 60 days, and others might see a different period, but 60-day window to try and limit the announcements.
Okay, we'll call a question then. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thanks. Report to Deakin Water Treatment Plant Efficiencies Review.
I'll move item number two.
Okay. Councillor Gillingham?
Just have a couple questions. I don't know if the administration's available for a couple questions on it.
Morning. Welcome.
Morning. Yes, Councillor.
Yeah, just morning. So just looking back on this, I guess one of the questions is, I know we had outside legal, and I know that there's, given that there's an ongoing legal matter involved here, that it is a matter of privilege. So perhaps, I don't know what you can or can't say about that, about the overview of just the outside legal's findings, or if anything can be a high level said about that would help us, but not jeopardize anything future.
Sure, yeah, and thank you right off the bat for acknowledging that there are some limitations in terms of my ability to discuss it, particularly the ongoing litigation. What I can say, we obtained what I've determined was a comprehensive opinion from outside legal counsel. We asked legal counsel to take an independent look at particularly focusing on the timing issues, because of course that's germane to what we're dealing with, our limitation periods. We initially began by asking external counsel to assess the situation solely on the basis of the court record, so solely on the basis of the statement of claim, statements of defense, and other pleadings that were filed on the court pocket. External counsel has come back with a good, thorough opinion, and the most I'll say is that we're comfortable in terms of how we proceeded in terms of ending the litigation.
Okay. A couple of questions, I guess, I have in regards to the report. Just for clarity, on pages 8 and, well, I have it as 8 and 9 in my report, the chronology of events.
Okay.
So, I guess there's a couple areas that I guess probably on page 6 it talks about limitation periods for commencing an action expired for each contract between 2014 and 2015. So that's pretty broad range there. Specific dates and deadlines are not, like, there's not specific dates given there. But then when we go through here, the next page of pages 8 and 9, it talks about, for example, November 26, 2015, Mayor and Chair of Standing Policy Committee on Infrastructure Renewal Public Works approved the filing of the statement of claim. My assumption then, though, is that is past the date of the limitation period.
Yeah, just to clarify, the reason we didn't, in this chronology, we took EPC's direction to outline the administrative actions and inactions. So we did focus on the administrative actions as opposed to getting into the legal opinion and the different limitation periods. Just so everyone's clear, there wasn't one limitation period to be dealing with. As is made clear early on in the report under the history and discussion, there were numerous defendants. So the way one would assess the limitation period depends on the specific facts as it relates to each of those defendants, and therefore there are arguably different limitation periods for each of them. And so rather than get into each of the dozen or so limitation periods, we've simply summarized it as having them all expired in the 2014-2015 period. But yes, to answer your question about whether November 26, 2015 was beyond those limitation dates, that is our understanding. That's our conclusion.
I guess, why wouldn't deficiencies, if the deficiencies are being noticed by the department and being identified by the department, and it's a problem, why would those not be brought to the attention of the committee when those are first identified?
And by committee, you mean the standing policy?
Yeah, the standing policy committee on, or I guess any, to my knowledge, any committee, so whether it's water waste committee or because there's financial implications, the finance committee, is there...
What I may do is simply defer, as you're aware, Councillor, Water and Waste is coming up with a report, a much more detailed report concerning all of the deficiencies at the plant. They may be in a better position to discuss whether or not it was considered coming to committee at that time. Certainly internally within the public service, the deficiencies and the problems being encountered were being discussed actively. They were being discussed with our risk management division, as you can tell from the timeline. They were being discussed with legal as well. In terms of whether the trigger should have been activated to send another report up to the Standing Policy Committee, I will defer to Water and Waste on that one.
In your view, I guess my final question is, in your view then, does the city have any opportunity to recover any of the costs of deficiencies? That was really one of the key aspects of this motion, to see if there's any opportunity to recover any portion of the damages. So in your opinion, after all that you've seen and the report, is there any opportunity?
I'm only going to be measured because if I were discussing prospective litigation, that might be foolish in an open session. I'll perhaps just reiterate the conclusion I mentioned previously, which was the statement of claim filed against the defendants listed in this report. By discontinuing it, we are satisfied that that was the appropriate course of action.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. Councillor Mays, do you move?
I move.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Let's receive his information. Okay. Receive his info. Okay. Just for clarity.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Still up to council.
Okay. Yeah, of course. Okay. So report three is negotiations between the city and the Winnipeg Fire Paramedic Senior Officers Association. Councillor Gillingham?
Yes. I'd move this, Mr. Mayor. I think we just we had this come back just for a couple of non-material edits, I think, and changes. So,
Call it.
Mr. Fathers is here from the association, so part of our we've had a very good run of getting settlements here over the last year, so that just adds to that collection.
Agreed. Call the question then. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thanks. Report four is the Downtown Zoning Bylaw Review 2017.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This is a semi-annual review of our downtown bylaw. There's two ones of interest in here. That there's a number of tweaks and smaller little details, cleanups. But the two ones that are, I guess, of substance, of a little more substance, is first is about trees. They're trying to make sure that trees will be surviving as we densify. But it's difficult in these areas where they're so tight and compacted. So they're looking at a little bit smaller tree wells, but deeper. So they're hoping with a different type of varietal tree, it'll be able to survive better and we'll be able to include density. The other one is for microbreweries, allow them to have a retail opportunity. Again, to help support that industry a bit, there's been some requests by the industry to, these are small microbreweries, so they'll be able to sell maybe a few beer, their brand off. It won't be a vendor or a liquor store. It'll just be a little bit of retail, so they have to sell their own product. It won't be bringing other products to sell off. So again, it's a really booming and kind of exciting new industry that's happening in Winnipeg, and it's really actually adding quite a bit of life in our downtown. With some quite a bit of interest, and a lot of the ones with restaurants are doing very well. So again, it's to help the industry a little bit and also add a little more vitality.
I'll just echo your comments. I mean, it's quite a change. I remember after I went to University of Toronto and moved back to Winnipeg in 99, the downtown was very different than it is now. And that vibrancy, there's been a lot of good work by a lot of organizations, by previous council and this council, to continue the positive momentum downtown. We had 2,000 more people living downtown over the last, I think, about 5 years. And part of that reason is just the vitality that is being supported by changes like this. So I'm very pleased to support this. I'll call the question then. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Carried. Thanks. Report five is the request to amend the South Transcona Community Center boundary.
Yes, Mr. Mayor. We dealt with this at Standing Policy Committee on Protection, Community Services and Parks, and this has to do with the GCWCC is going to be reviewing the community center boundaries in light of the Ward Boundaries Commission changes that are taking effect on September 17th. And, of course, our city is continuing to grow. You've talked about that growing to 1 million people in 2025, and so this is in line with that, and so I'd like to move with the two recommendations.
I think the numbers are, just because we're unanswered, I think the Conference Board of Canada has it a few more years out, but we are definitely growing. So, point well taken.
Comment, of course.
Yeah.
You mentioned the Council Pack again. I just want to clarify. It's a request to amend the South Transcona Community Center boundary, but my understanding is that they'll be looking at all the boundaries now.
Correct. Yeah, thank you, Councillor Oloko, for that question. This is to look at a citywide view. The GCWCC is going to be doing a community center district boundary review for the whole city. And this particular motion came out of a community committee for EKT regarding a proposal. So we're receiving that kind of as information and sort of looking at the larger review.
Just a question on that. So that would hold true then for, I guess, there will be a review of, maybe the clerk's going to answer, a review of the community committee's realignment of them, right, if we've got kind of wards shifting somewhat. And so I'd imagine that will come forward at some point, too, as far as the the new community committees? Do the clerks determine that, or is that something council, I guess, would have to approve, or maybe?
Yes, we would be something that we're currently looking at right now, and would be submitted, and it works hand in hand with this.
Okay. And that sentiment. Council Gillihan for that comment. That sentiment is captured in the motion. As part of the discussion, that community center committee boundaries haven't yet been finalized, so this is also in line with that.
Okay, we'll call the question then. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thanks. Report 6 is citizen member appointments.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, we have a motion here regarding the Forks North Portage Partnership and the Vehicle for Hire Appeal Board. I'll just read out the resolution for the partnership. The Forks, therefore, be resolved that Cheyenne Thomas be appointed as a citizen member of the Forks North Portage Partnership Board of Directors for a 3-year term expiring December 31st, 2020. And for the Vehicle for Hire Appeal Board, therefore be it resolved that the following citizens be appointed to the Vehicle for Hire Appeal Board for an initial 1-year term expiring December 31st, 2018, Jordan Levine and Lisa Patterson. And number 2, for a 2-year term expiring December 31st, 2019, Kara Bjornson, Chairperson, Iris Morel, and Jose Tomas as Vice Chair.
Thank you. I'll call a question. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thanks. Our next report is Report 7, Land Dedication Reserve Fund.
I'll move concurrence with the Community Committee recommendation found at number 7.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Report 8 is Single Source Negotiation Award of Contract for Legal Services Related to Commercial Arbitration.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, I do note that the report indicates and outlines some changes that are being implemented to enhance this in the future, and so I would move this report.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thanks. Report 9, single source negotiation from Manitoba Hydro Works.
I'll move the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Report 10, single source negotiations award a contract for the year 2018 for Indigenous awareness, cultural training consultants.
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Next one is the amendment to the Live Downtown Rental Development Grant Program.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This continues. This is actually a good news story again for the downtown. It extends a year out the grant opportunities for some of our recent developments that who have applied before. It really pertains to the bigger projects that are out there. They're having a hard time getting in, and so I thank the province for extending it for the year because these projects are a go. It's just a matter of getting the financing and everything in order. The program's a little restrictive on its timelines, which I think is good, but this gives it a one more year so we can get some of those larger projects like Artist Reap, up in the air.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thanks. Report 12 is the information sharing agreement for Enterprise Mobility Management System.
Yeah, I'd like to move this. I mean, this is a really, really good project as we're getting more and more mobile. We're getting more and more techie here. It's important that we're protecting that equipment and making sure that we are protected when we're out in the field. So
that's what the report says. It refers to the
as a Gary's term.
Yeah. I didn't see that in the report. Okay, so we'll call the question. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thank you. Report 13 is single source negotiation and award contract for the extended warranty repair and maintenance of online parking revenue control system.
I'd like to move that one as well.
Sure. Councillor Gillian.
Thank you. We had laid this one over just to get some clarity, and I'm wondering if maybe CEO or someone from Mr. Topolinski could provide insight for us.
Morning, welcome, councillors.
Hey.
Councillor Gillian, do you have any specific questions?
Sure, yeah, I appreciate that. I was just wondering, I know we laid the matter over. We were looking at a single source negotiation award contract for 1 year, an extended year, but in speaking at the last meeting, the CAO had indicated that, you know, we may be here again 1 year from now. So the question I had asked is there any value in looking at a multi-year award or a multi-year extension of contract? Could we get better pricing if we have to go two or more years? And so that was the initial question that I had. The other one I'm wondering is, further to that, a little bit of back and forth, is that If eventually we're going to be removing a certain number of pay stations, can we retain those pay stations? And maybe this is wrong, but can you use parts from the ones you've taken out of service to service the remaining pay stations? So those two questions are the ones I really had.
So yeah, to answer the first question, really the ability to do it in a 1 year term, if we don't have that, it's really the flexibility, and it actually plays into partially. As we look forward, and as we we are considering removing some more of the pay stations, this just allows us to be flexible with the contract price. The second part of your question, with regards to any of the machines that we've taken off the street, for example, the solar panels, we do actually take those good components off of them, log them, and keep them on hand. Certainly, the other major components are covered, like the motherboards, for example, are a significant more of a cost. That falls under the warranty repair piece that you really wouldn't want to use a 12 or 13-year-old board when our warranty program can actually cover that for a brand new one versus having that go out of service. So there is, again, flexibility, and that is covered under those different programs. It's worked quite well. We've had these machines now since about 2005. Some of them are being on the street. This really does work well with keeping them up and running, even in the cold weather.
So if I'm understanding the answer to the first question, you're saying it would not be to the city's advantage to enter into a contract over multi-years for servicing on X number of units when we are reducing the number of units probably within the next 12 months. Am I understanding that correctly?
Yes, a lot of these costs are fixed costs. For example, like a big portion right now of that is about a third, close to a third, is actually data costs. So really, those are costs that are fixed, and really it is dependent, again, on the numbers of machines that we actually have still up and running. So when you look at where we can in the variable pieces, like the paper and that, certainly the more we switch over to pay by phone, the potential for paper to be reduced is that greater. So there's those flexibility in the variable costs, which can go down. So that's how it's worked, and certainly we need to look at it from that two perspectives, the fixed that we have and then the variable.
Okay. Thank you. That's helpful. I appreciate your answers.
Thank you. Thank you.
Any further questions?
Okay. Thank you. Call the question then. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Carried. Thanks. We'll move to audit committee. First one is the audit plan January 2018 update.
Mr. Mayor, I'll be happy to move item number one.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Report two, Winnipeg Police Service Headquarters construction project status. Audit recommendations 2017 quarter four.
Yes, I'd be happy to move this, just noting that there was 19 recommendations made and 18 have been implemented. The last one is looking to be implemented in the second quarter of 2018. And many of the recommendations, Mr. Mayor, that management is adopting really are in line with the major project management and capital project management, as well as our asset management. So really good principles, again, in line with adopting asset management as a core business principle within the City of Winnipeg. So
thanks.
Happy to move that.
Thanks for pointing that out, Councillor, and thanks for your efforts as Council Liaison for Project Management. I'll call a question then. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Carried. Thanks. Report 3 is report on new fire paramedic stations, construction project status, of audit recommendation 2017 quarter 4.
Yeah, I'll be happy to move item number 3.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Carried. Report 4, quarterly report card 2017 quarter 4.
Move that as well, Mr. Mayor.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye. Aye.
Carried. Report 5, audit of the Legal Services Department.
And move number 5.
I'll just point out, it's I'm pleased to see the recommendations of the auditor being fully implemented. I think they're obviously they're needed, and so appreciate the work of everyone involved to make some needed changes. Call a question then. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Committee reports. We'll move to Standing Policy Committee on Infrastructure Renewal and Public Works. Councilor Rents.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'd like to move report number 1. It comes about as a result of a decision of an arbitration with respect to the Jubilee Rapid Transit Station. So I'll move that report.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thanks. We'll move to Standing Policy Committee on Water, Waste, Riverbank Management, and the Environment. Councillor Mays.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to pull 1 and 4, so I'll move 2 and 3.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Councilor Mays?
Just as to number one, that's the pilot project. Mr. Delbridge was here earlier. Some very good work by the staff working with QP to set up this model. So I think do think it makes sense to get our foot in the door with the contract, the multifamily contract that's envisaged here, rather than doing the bulky waste, which is much more particular and self-contained. So this will hopefully give us the chance to see how we can do with in-house collection, and in the long run, the 6 years or so down the line, when we're looking to renew on the big contracts for garbage and recycle, we'll have an idea of whether we like Ottawa, can have some sort of in-house capability to help help ensure that their costs are contained.
Councilor Gillingham.
Thank you.
As I shift to the right of the table.
There you go. Off the segue to maybe me saying, I don't know if I would describe it as getting foot in the door, but I would describe it as an opportunity here for us to do a I think a thorough cost analysis, a thorough comparative. I know in our department, in our community meeting, our water waste committee meeting, we did talk about and then further to what Mr. Delbridge has said, when the cost analysis is done, when we're doing the comparative, it really does need to be a robust analysis, so that we are, you know, fully costing out salaries, benefits, pensions, equipment, leases, insurance, etc., and all that on the equipment that the city would be using to fulfill this multifamily solid waste collection service. And so, you know, I said it there, and I think we all said it there. Really, what we're looking for, ultimately, in my view, is the best service for the best value for the citizens of Winnipeg. And if we can have this pilot project and from it do a comparator that's accurate and fair, then I think we certainly would all welcome that. So I'm fully supportive of this pilot project.
Thanks, Councillor. I'll call the question then. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Carried. Thanks. Okay, we will move to standing polls. Was that? Sorry?
I pulled four as well.
Oh, sorry. I apologize. So, Councillor, over to you.
This is the China item. This is the steps necessary to deal with the increased quality standards being mandated by the government of China for recycling material. I just pull it to commend our staff. I see the Director Gear is here. They responded quite quickly, gave us a comprehensive proposal here, as we have not ended up in the situation of some other cities that are burning plastic bags, are having to stockpile massive amounts of stuff, basically, recyclables. So we've had some good work from the staff. Hopefully we can get this implemented. And yes, there is a cost. On the other hand, it appears to be the best of a series of bad options in front of us. And this way we can keep our recycling going.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Orlico?
I have a few questions to administration, if I may.
Sure. More reckon. Good morning and welcome.
Good morning, EPC members.
So my questions are brings me back to the good old days when I recall markets shutting down on you.
You were gonna
and,
say that.
I know, and you had a stockpile. I remember those days when we were all the beginning of the recycling world in Manitoba, and this happened. This happened much more frequently back then, where markets would just shut down, and you had a stockpile forever, or dispose of if you had to. So back in those days, the group that I was with, we all agreed that when we do our business plans, we have to ensure, and it maybe is better now, as my question is leading to, that we, as part of our revenue, we don't include recyclable materials. It's too risky. You don't know if you're actually going to be able to sell it. You don't know when you're going to be able to sell it. So we took that, most of us, including Planet Recycling and Red Box Recycling, we all took it off our business plans as it was a bonus if you got it, but you don't want to rely your business on it. So I guess my question to the city of Winnipeg is, first of all, how much do we rely, we pay processing costs to this group, Intera group, whatever they're called. Do we get money from the materials overall? And so when we sell the materials or we give it to this group, do they give us money back, or is it kind of a zero to zero, or in this case, less than zero? How does that work?
the city actually gets the revenue from the sale of the commodities, the recyclable products. Okay. So that's in our solid waste utility. We get those revenues, and you're correct, Councillor, that the prices do fluctuate because they're market-based prices. So we have to build that buffer and that into our budget because you can't rely on the prices because they do change month by month for whatever is in the commodity stream. So, but the revenue does come back to the City of Winnipeg Solid Waste Utility.
So if I hive this piece off here, there's increased sorting cost, really, it sounds like, to make sure that the paper bundles are of a higher quality. The 1.5 million, is that right? Total direct cost.
That's correct. Yeah. So how contract over expenditure?
So now, so we get X amount. Do we still make money on the recyclables even with this addition of the additional costs? Are we still in the plus on the when take processing and sale on the recyclables themselves?
What happens in the business case to come forward with the recommendation to for the over expenditure? The work that's required to maintain the quality of the material is out of scope of the existing contract. So we've requested that over expenditure so that we can do the additional processing and cut our losses. So in the report, it's it's sort of a cost to the city of roughly $200,000 versus $3 million, because if we hadn't made the improvements to the process, we would have no market, and we would be like some other jurisdictions where we would be landfilling it or stockpiling it or the like. So we've actually, and of course, the what's evolving in China, it's, as you understand, Councillor, it's very volatile.
Next question, but my quick question, though, is we sell it for this much and it costs us this much now to produce it. Are we breaking even or are we making money on it?
We're not in the report. I'm sorry, I'm just
page six.
I'm looking for that.
Top of page six.
The report we have we've got there's a table in the report, and I'm just getting to it. I'm sorry, pardon me.
Okay.
I lost a sticky or two in this binder. In the report, I'm sorry, this is in the report on my page five, if we did nothing, it would cost the city $3.7 million.
Right.
By going to the over expenditure, it will cost the city $300,000. So we do expect that there could be a net cost to the city because of the market situation. But if we did nothing, we're
more. No, I get that point completely. I'm just trying to see what the impact is to our overall revenue, because I understand we have included the revenue from the sale of materials as part of our budget.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I misunderstood the question. Actually, the price right now, the revenue, we're not expecting the price to go down.
Okay, that's why.
Yeah, no, so we don't expect the price to go down based upon the commodity prices right now are pretty much tracking to what they were last year. Winnipeg's fortunate product. That we still can sell the product to China.
Yeah. That's good. So I guess my second question, has any other materials been affected? Aluminum, glass is worse than paper. Are we still able to, our glass, would we still be able to recycle our glass in the near future, or are you concerned about that?
The market for, like, the markets are always evolving and changing, and that's why when we have these contracts for processing, they're long-term, but they have to have the flexibility in them as well to deal with markets that appear, because there may be new products that come into the recycling stream, there may be other products that come out. The only product right now that we do that's been impacted is the mixed paper, which is what's this report. Everything else is...
Do you foresee anything else in this vein? China's putting down all their plants. Paper's the first one. But we know that they, and I've read, they're not that keen on glass. Will be another one they'll be looking at shortly, if not already. Commingled glass, it's dirty and they don't want it, and it's heavy. So is there anything else you're aware of that may be also impacted by this, I guess, environmental reconsolidation in China that our markets may disappear on? Is there anything you're aware of at this point?
No, not from the China market.
That's a big one right now.
It's paper and plastics.
Really,
and plastics we're not impacted by.
The glasses, so we're okay.
We're okay.
Well, again, I would say congratulations on securing the market. And do we know how long? Do we expect anything else out of the paper market from China in the near future? Or do we have any indications that they may be even more stringent or just stop taking period because they have their own capacity at this point? Do you ever hear anything more of that? Or is it kind of, this is the stage we're at?
Well, this is where we're at right now, but we're continuing to monitor it at least monthly, if not daily, because with the specifications that they put out for the quality of the product, they may find themselves in a difficult situation because they won't get the supply that they need. So I think it's it continues to evolve. So it could become stricter or less strict, but we continue to monitor it.
Okay. So right now, we're recycling all our goodies. We are getting recycling done, and our markets are secure. We're using the tail a little bit more to do better sorting to make sure we get the paper market, which is 70% of our product. Our volume.
So. That's correct.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks. We'll call the question then. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thanks.
Mr. Mayor, I was wondering if, given Ms. Gear is here, would we be able to circle back to that question I had earlier of Mr. Jack in regards to the Deakin Water Plan as far as the committee being aware? Is that possible?
We already dealt with the other.
Can we ask questions? Yeah. Okay, we've already voted on the matter, but how do we do process-wise in terms of asking questions?
This would just be a question of the administration, but it wouldn't be specific to that report that we've already dealt with. If the committee wanted to revisit that report, we could consider it again. We could rescind the previous motion and consider the report again, but this would just be a question of the administration.
Okay, now that we got that on the record.
Okay, I'll ask a question of the administration, if I may. I should have for Ms. Gear at that time. So I'm just wondering, my question is in regards to the Deakin Water Plant. I know the chronology, a lot of it predates my time, predates your time in your current role. I'm just wondering, to your knowledge, was the committee, the elected committee, made aware of deficiencies for the plant? I mean, we're looking at 2010, 2012, 2013. Was the committee made aware of those deficiencies? And if not, why not, to your knowledge?
Hey, Councillor, I don't know that answer. I know that we have standard processes at the city where if within the department there were deficiencies, we would kick in and meet with our, I think as Mr. Jack indicated earlier, with risk management and with our legal services group. But certainly we have a report coming to Councillor May's committee on the operational deficiencies, so we can come prepared to that meeting to answer that question.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, so we'll move to our last standing policy committee is Property and Development, Heritage, and Downtown Development. Councillor Olico, over to you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I will move items 1... through 5, okay. Polls 6 and 7, move 8, move poll 9,
okay.
Move 10 through 14.
Okay, so just for clarity, we're moving, voting on 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 8, 10 through 14 inclusive.
Could I pull 12?
Except for 12. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. We'll move to report 6, list of historical resources. Councillor Olico.
I pulled this down on request of a colleague.
Just one question. I'm just wondering if the chair can give us some insight as to whether the congregation of the Ukrainian Metropolitan Cathedral is supportive of this designation, or any comments in regards to the congregation's view of this.
This is a little complicated one. The issue really became these very large, inaccessible stairs that made a lot of the was a major feature of the church that they had. The church had a problem with retaining. That was a big issue they had, the stairwell. because it just had it's one of those old grand concrete stairs out front. So they are interested in looking at a couple of designs in which they would have a lift station, a little elevator, and kind of a little spot to the side. So the first time the group came forward, their design was not supported by anybody, including themselves, it appears. The previous design, it just didn't work well. So what they've done now is they come back with two options. One was to put the lift, rip out the stairs completely, and put the lift right on the front of the facade of the building. Kind of wasn't in line with what we were hoping for, because it actually blocked the facade of the whole building. So what they've done is between those two buildings, there you'll see, they've added a little parish hall, I guess we'll call it, and then they'll have access going off up the side. They did not come to the committee to oppose when the revised plan was put forward. There was a request by the group to be able to remove, or at least keep an option to remove those stairs off the front. The committee was not that keen on it. We believe the stairs are integral parts, so that they can be barricaded off, maybe with some historical plaques up front, and not use it. And it's been done before. Got concerned about maybe some of the skateboard kids and stuff, but they seem to be okay with that. But if there is a problem coming forward, they will come back and ask for our indulgences about the stairs. But I think in the end of the day, I would say all parties gave a little and were okay with it.
Thanks.
Okay. Call the question then. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Report 7, list of historical resources nomination.
I'd just point this one out. The number of historical resources that the city is nominating is quite impressive. We're averaging 2 to 4 a month. And this is to preserve our historical stock of buildings that have a lot of benefit. But as we go forward, we know technology is changing a bit. So in this particular instance, we did approve it. However, it's really we're finding the issue about windows in general. Mostly the type of materials that we've asked the Heritage Group to look at. And it's looking at PVC now, as the material has improved dramatically. We've asked the historical committee to look at the option of actually at least allowing the option to be looked at of PVC windows, because some of the new windows, it really is windows get expensive, especially when you're looking at wood or you're looking at some of the more inset ones. So again, we're trying to help the industry and these people as well by providing affordable options as well that keeps in line with historical character. So that's it.
Thanks, Councillor. I'll call the question then. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Next one, I believe, is 9, which is the request to amend servicing agreement condition. This is the matter we heard from delegation earlier. If I could ask a member of the public service to be able to come up and
kind
of walk us through their recommendation. Morning. Welcome.
Mr. Mayor, councillors. Do you want me to take you through just sort of from a public service perspective context on it?
Yeah.
I mean, 20 seconds. That's, or... in essence, the good presentation, we're supportive of the project. The site came with some liabilities, and I think the developer pointed out a number of those, bought with a coulee, bought against the rail line, and the site did come with liabilities or costs that would have to be paid back to the Pembina Avenue redevelopment. For context, Pembina Avenue is not their front door. In fact, it's a Ducharme address. That's why you're seeing it that way. But because the properties touch on Pembina Highway, there are some costs with the redevelopment of Pembina Highway. In essence, we're big fans from a public service perspective of pre-development applications. So coming in for a pre-app, as we call it, identifies all the concerns and constraints associated with the site. We always say it's the best $500 you'll pay as a developer for investing and your risks. All of these items were identified in the pre-development application, were also contained in the report. So it was not an unknown cost. What was presented is it has become prohibitive with the culmination of a number of costs associated with the project and the property. In essence, this is a policy under the development agreement parameters that's applied. It includes basically a lane of the road, the sidewalk, the trees, the landscaping, et cetera. I believe the cost came in about 15% higher at the pre-app and then was reduced because, in essence, there were no trees in front of this property, so there's some deductions for what's actually at your site. The applicant also identified that as these properties are rezoned, be it from residential or agricultural lands to a higher use, the costs were applied. They were upfronted in essence, basically, from the general tax revenue. Taxpayers in general have upfronted those costs. As the development occurs, it's not to be punitive on those that are there owning the property, but as development occurs, compensation is made. So it's basically included on that. I would identify, however, that when they appealed to us and they said there were other properties that it had not been applied to, we went back over the last 14 to basically 18 years to look at other properties on Pembina Highway. There were four that were identified that had been moved from RR1 or residential to commercial or agricultural to be rezoned. Fees were not applied in those circumstances. Those are the four that I've identified. I can't speculate as to why they were not charged. That, in essence, working with Public Works, they identify, you know, under the development agreement parameters, we identify costs that are applied. And this is a citywide. This is not just about Pembina Highway. This is a citywide policy that's applied through the development agreement parameters. So what we would really say is, great project, lots of costs associated with this site, but is the fee by policy should be applied. And it is applied throughout the rest of the city as well.
Thank you. Not hearing any other questions, then?
I got a few. Okay. So just to clarify, generally what I'm hearing from the applicant, I've heard it twice now, and I respect what they're saying. It because of the hydro line, because of the retaining wall, and because of the loss of developable space because of Cooley, those costs, we agree, understand all those costs. Cooley's filling up in part because of the development, because of the runoff, but that's fine. They want to waive the other fee in front, because I don't think they can really waive, as I said, we can't really waive the other stuff.
Yeah.
We need to build that retention wall. We have no building to fill the space. They want to get right to the line. So on the retention wall, the SEM guidelines that we adopted, that was about 2-3 years ago?
Correct.
So that's why that was kicking in.
Yeah.
And he said the other guys didn't have to do it. But this is guidelines come in play at certain times, and these guidelines came in, and council approved the SEM guidelines, and this is part of that. So that's why I would counter why the other guys didn't have to do it. Mm-hmm. Well, because we didn't have those guidelines in play, they probably should. But again, that's the past. So I clarify that. And the hydro bearing the lines, that's not us, is it? It's like, is that a hydro requirement, or is that our requirement?
I believe that's a hydro requirement.
So I thought.
Yeah.
Okay. So the idea about the Cooley and the issue about the retention wall and the development agreement parameters, the applicant was aware of all those.
Yes.
Okay. So he did make the application in full knowledge. Mm-hmm. And so that's where... And that was something I think that tilted the committee last time. Yeah, well, we respect the fact that there are some additional costs. Infill is not cheap. We know that. Sometimes it's, and this is a good example where infill is expensive. So what I'm generally hearing, though, is if an infill project has additional costs that are above and beyond a greenfield or by a rail line, we should waive the development agreement parameters to offset those costs. And that's generally what they're asking for, isn't it?
That is their request, that the development agreement parameters be adjusted for this project at this location.
Because of the additional costs on the land. So
correct.
Anybody who actually builds by a rail line could also expect that same kind of treatment.
And our concern from a public service perspective related to the development agreement parameters is the precedent-setting nature of if there's something to give, it would be a consideration or forgiveness under development agreement that many other properties coming forward have paid for.
And I'm not saying it shouldn't be a policy. We should maybe look at that as a policy and maybe the guidelines that should become into the policy play. But right now, that's generally what's being asked for.
Correct.
We have extra costs on our site. Either it could be water, but again, you can even get into water retention. Mm-hmm. I have to build an on-site retention pond. I didn't expect to pay that cost. It's burdensome. So can you waive another fee for me? Yeah. That's generally what I heard today, what they wanted.
You're correct. And the other aspect was, from their perspective, is this consistently applied? We would say we always attempt to apply it consistently.
And on that point, so the properties that they're on, not just the other Ducharme and the other those properties up there before they mentioned, this was actually a new piece today. So I know what the RR5 they have to pay.
Yes.
Or the R1 to RMF, right? They have to pay?
It's from agricultural to or rural residential along, right. that the additional fee comes into play, and it's paid once, and then that property is clear and free for subsequent rezonings.
So only when they go from that RR5 or whatever it is,
yeah.
and zone up, right?
Correct.
So of the other properties I mentioned back there, you know, were they didn't pay a fee because they already were zoned? Were they all RR5?
Multiple properties paid fees. There were four that we identified through our land development and with Public Works that over the last 14 years did not pay as they were rezoned. And I can't speculate on those reasons for why either they were missed but when it was identified through Public Works capital process, or there were other considerations taken into effect.
So missing concerns me. Mm-hmm. In that regards, and I know how planning property seems to, you know, because you kind of lead most things to get blamed for everything, but in this regard, it'd be, you would ask, is that the requirement of Public Works to do the servicing agreement, to identify this, that needs to be paid? Would that be the, we gotta get, I'm worried that we're missing others, which is my concern. So I need, yeah. we're gonna have to visit how we miss things.
We coordinate the land development component. Through land development, a number of other departments feed into that. Mm-hmm. With their requirements, it's in the ACG reports, Administrative Coordinating Group report. We assemble that information or those requests, which are multiple on some sites. And in these cases, we went back through and said, yes, not sure why those others were not included.
But the idea that just because we missed it one time, does that justify that we shouldn't have to pay in the future because we missed something in the past?
I sometimes equate it to, if you trip on a step going up a set of stairs, you'd always trip there. We would hate for this to become precedent setting, nor should we waive it because we had in other cases.
With regards to these four that you've referenced, were these were the waivers provided by elected officials or by the public service?
Ms. Mayor, I can't speak to that. I don't have the history on each of those files. That's something we could provide, however.
Are there time sensitivities on this file if we were to delay while we wait for that information?
I would think from a developer perspective, yeah. there may be, yes.
Okay.
Is there an opportunity to go back on these properties, the ones that were missed? And levy the charge?
Do we
have that ability?
We don't. We did look at that as you know, if this was not charged, should it have been? It's not something we've historically done. The rezoning is the rezoning, and it may be multiple owners down the road. That's the issue.
Just one point of clarification: the letter from the architect, when they describe the cost, it says the total cost of this item came as a shock to our clients. I didn't hear that in the presentation of the architect. The strain on the development part, I get, the cumulative effect of all of the other things. From your perspective, is that statement accurate? Because you said earlier that it was addressed.
The statement is not accurate.
Is it addressed through the pre-app?
Yes. The statement in the letter is not accurate. And we clarified with the applicant at Standing Policy Committee because they had made that statement at that time of, in fact, they may... the person making the presentation may not have been aware, but the developer and the applicant, that was identified as a hard number in the upfront cost based on frontage on Pemmon Highway. So it was conveyed early, but in essence, it's with the other constraints has proved challenging.
And just one other quick question: Do we have the ability to allow the payment over a number of years, or does it have to be a one-time?
I think you may have stumped me, Councillor. We typically say we can hold letters of credit. We can there can be some flexibility, I would think. I'd have to explore it.
Okay.
Yeah.
I definitely understand the concerns of the developer. This, it is an odd lot, and we do want to do the infill. So I respect that completely. I stand by the initial decision of the community, of the standing committee, though. They were aware. But I guess if there is something that we can do to help this developer out in within our policy, it would be appreciated if this vote goes through as is. But I don't want to leave here thinking that we're totally blind to the fact that we do want infill. The development looks quite impressive, but we also have policy. Thank you.
Councillor Mace?
That was a pretty eloquent summary from Councillor Orlico. I mean, I'll stay with the position I had at the Community Committee, and Councillor Lutz has put a lot of time in on this, can speak more eloquently to it at Council, perhaps, or in the if there's something that can be done between now and Council. As Councillor Orlico said, we do want to encourage infill projects like this. A lot of time has been spent. We've certainly heard about the Cooley business and the Crashwell business at the Community Committee, so I tend to think maybe there were some exceptional circumstances here, though. I appreciate what Councillor Orlico is saying and what Mr. Kiernan is saying is that there are certain rules, and I know there's some ag land, some south of the perimeter in my ward that where I would want these sorts of limits around retaining green space, around retaining setback from the rail line to be implemented. So I appreciate what Councillor Lutz was saying.
Maybe if I could just ask that the public service, and this may be cross-departmental, but if we could get some follow-up on those other items, and maybe just ask that you inform members of council with a better explanation of why those fees may have been waived in the past for other properties. In the meantime, I'm comfortable supporting the public services recommendation on this matter.
And we can provide that history, Mr. Mayor, before council next week.
Oh. Yeah. Thank you. Okay. Call the question. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Yes.
Thank
you very much.
Move consent agenda and adjournment, Mr. Mayor.
That is, we have one more.
Sorry.
Nice try. We have report 12. This is the last matter. This is a appropriation matter. Councillor Orlico.
I pulled it.
Sorry, who pulled it?
I pulled it.
Sorry. So we'll go to Councillor Mace.
Number 12 is just worth noting that we spent a very long time at the budget deliberations hearing about South Winnipeg Rec Center. While here we are taking concrete action down in St. Norbert, South Winnipeg Ward, to move forward with the project, as it's referred to multiple times in here. So we'll let the staff implement this, but let it not be said that we're... That's too many negatives, and I didn't get much sleep. Let it be said, we're taking some action on the South Winnipeg Rec Center.
We'll see.
And if I miss my administration to give us maybe an update, if there's maybe an opportune time, the Waverly West D plan is happening, with maybe an update on the whole project itself.
Thank you. There's about 400 acres still in Waverly West that requires a secondary plan. That process is currently underway to set some clarity around that acreage. And that's for those of you that go out there between Bridgewater Forest and South Point. That's that piece of undeveloped. In essence, there's some large residential and some ag land that's out there and that will be coming on stream. A number of years ago, Pembina Trail School Division, 3 years ago, identified a 20-acre parcel that they bought for a high school and elementary school. And the intent with the Waverly West development had always been to co-locate a recreation center in partnership with the community, YMYWCA, adjacent, be co-located for a destination site. We've also looked at that site for public works yards, park and rides, library, all of those on an integrated campus for that quadrant of the city. And we see this as the next step in securing lands. It's co-located with the high school that we anticipate coming be under review at the current time and maybe announced very shortly to allow those elements to be planned in an integrated, coherent manner for that quadrant of the city. And we see it as a positive all round. And I can't remember if we also have identified from a transit perspective the opportunity at now a 40-acre site that's being consolidated for transit, park and ride. So there's lots of good things, and I think it's a great synergy and opportunity for multiple partners to coexist on the same site and provide a community service.
Thank you. Thanks for all your efforts as well. I know a lot of us are working really hard to provide services that are needed in that area of our city, which is growing. So thank you.
Thanks.
We'll call the question then. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Councilor Pagan.
Consent to that adjournment.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thanks, everyone. Have a great day.
Thank you, Councilor.